From where we previously left off, the RMS Titanic left Southampton on her maiden voyage. Along the way, she almost had a near collision with the SS City of New York, thus therefore, her leave-in was delayed by a half hour. Then later that night, she would arrive at Cherbourg, France. She would stay for a few hours to pick up more passengers and more mail from the tender ships, the Nomadic, and the Traffic. Once she finally stayed for a few hours, she then raised anchor and set sail to Queenstown, Ireland, her final stop before sailing to New York.
Today, it is April 11, 2024. 112 years ago today, the RMS Titanic made her final stop at the town of Queenstown, Ireland, which is now present-day Cove, pick up and drop off more passengers. Now, in this part whatsoever, I'm actually going to cover her sea days from April 11th all the way before the iceberg collision on April 14th of 1912. So this is basically going to be one huge part, so that way you can get a lot of information instead of me having to do individual videos of per days. So that way this video is much more longer, it's much more better. That way there's a lot of information in there that I'm actually going to share with you guys. So we're going to get started, and also if you happen to like this Titanic documentary, feel free to subscribe for more ship documentaries like this. I am planning on making some in the future, especially with the first week of May, which is going to be the RMS Lusitania, so feel free to check that one out. And also another one, maybe a mini one at the end of May, which is going to be the Empress of Ireland. So without further ado, we're going to go ahead and get started with this Titanic documentary.
It is April 11th of 1912, 112 years ago, like I said in the beginning, that the RMS Titanic arrived at Queenstown, Ireland to pick up most third-class passengers, and also some passengers actually disembarked, to which that we will cover later on.
So while docked at Queenstown, now what they actually did, they rather pull up out in the water and rather prefer to let the two tender ships instead of basically, you know, just waste a lot of time trying to get the Titanic into Queenstown port. So basically, instead, they actually decided to send out two tender ships, which is the Ireland and the America, and both are paddle steamers. Now, while docked, it is an overcast day. And what the passengers did not know prior before going to Queenstown, Ireland, is that the Titanic did these big sweeping maneuvers, which is basically the helmsman basically testing out the maneuverability, and it can actually be seen in this photo from Francis Brown whatsoever on board the RMS Titanic.
Titanic arrived at Queenstown, Ireland at Roche's Point Outer Anchorage, which is now called Cove, Ireland. Tenders paddle steamer Ireland and America were waiting in the dock to transport 123 passengers on board, mostly were third-class passengers, and they too had to go through health inspections to make sure they also go into America disease-free. While I'm actually not going to cover the paddle steamers, I have narrated a video in the past about these two, and I will either leave a card or a link down in the description box below to check them out.
So next to the tenders, there were actually a few smaller vessels that actually carried vendors, set sail, actually to meet the Titanic offshore. They're basically, you know, selling local specialties such as lace and crafts to the wealthy first-class passengers. And since the Titanic is actually a Royal Mail ship or a Royal Mail steamer, the ship is actually contracted to take on bags of mail, which is heading all to North America whatsoever. So while at anchor, seven passengers actually disembarked. A notable one is actually Francis Brown, who actually got off as on the ship as the ship was actually anchored at Queenstown, Ireland. The reason why that he did this is because he befriended a American billionaire couple on board the RMS Titanic and basically sent a telegram to his supervisor saying, "Hey, can I spend time with this American billionaire couple? They're actually going to pay for me to go back to Ireland." So his superior actually told him to get off that ship. And little he knew, he was right.
The last few photographs that you see of the RMS Titanic came from Francis Brown as he was disembarking from one of the tender ships. He also took the last known photograph of Captain Smith alive, looking down from the starboard bridge wing of the Titanic.
And along with those departing, there was an unexpected departure of a crewman by the name of John Coffey, who is a fireman and is actually a native of Queenstown, Ireland, who deserted the ship. So basically, he just signed on to the Titanic and decided to have a free passage all the way to Queenstown, Ireland, and basically disembark from there. At 1:30 p.m., Titanic exchanged whistles with the tenders to return to the dock, and Titanic finally raised anchor to the strains of Aaron's Lament, which is played by Eugene Daly, and set off for his first transatlantic voyage. Francis Brown, or the O'Dell family, who is also another group that actually disembarked from the Titanic, took the last known photographs of the Titanic. Now, I'm actually going to do a video about the amateur photographers of the Titanic, because you have to remember, Titanic is not a very documented ship. So basically, everything that you see in books and everything, they basically came from the RMS Olympic.
Just as Titanic was leaving Queenstown, Ireland, there's another ship that's going to be mentioned in this part, but we'll actually mention it a little bit later on. It's the RMS Carpathia, a Cunard liner left from New York to Fiume, Austria-Hungary, which is now present-day Rijeka, Croatia, under the command of Captain Arthur Rostrum. At this time, the ship was carrying 240 crew members, a quarter of the crew were actually Croatian sailors, 128 first-class passengers, 50 second-class passengers, and 565 third-class passengers. Little they knew, they were going to be a part of history forever.
And also, a lighthearted event as well, Jack Phillips celebrates his 25th birthday on board the RMS Titanic.
The two men you see in this photo is Jack Phillips and Harold Bride. Both are Marconi operators on board the RMS Titanic. While en route to Queenstown, Ireland, Harold Bride decides to surprise Jack Phillips for his 25th birthday on board the RMS Titanic.
By the next afternoon, we were steaming west from the coast of Ireland, with nothing out ahead of us but ocean.
It is now April 12th of 1912. 112 years ago today, the RMS Titanic was out at sea for her first time. And let me tell you one thing, when you first heard this line from the 1997 movie from Gloria Stewart, you know this ship is now out at sea for the first time. Passengers and crew were starting to get acquainted and accustomed to the ship, you know, different routines and everything. Now, around this time frame, the weather is actually very, very comfortable, which is about 60 degrees during noontime whatsoever. And there was actually a cold front that was from the west and north of the ship whatsoever. Now, you have to keep this in mind though. Titanic wasn't actually going for a speed record of any kind whatsoever. In fact, the last boiler room, which is boiler room number one, which is right around back here, wasn't even lit. So boiler room one wasn't actually turned on for any reason whatsoever, especially during the sinking whatsoever.
Titanic would receive its first ice warning from a ship named the La Touraine. This letter is actually addressed to Captain Smith, thus congratulating him on his new command and added on a, oh, here's some ice at this area. The message was handed to Captain Smith, and even though it didn't cause any alarm whatsoever since ice is common in early spring, the position of the reported ice is given to 4th Officer Joseph Boxhall and marked the position on the map in the chart room.
So another notable event actually did happen on board the ship. It's actually regarding to the ship's designer, Thomas Andrews. You see, since Thomas Andrews is from Ireland, he had to leave his wife and daughter behind because he had to work on board the Titanic, you know, figure out everything, you know, from troubleshooting and finding out, you know, whether to do improvements. Like, if you ever seen Titanic and you notice he has a little black notebook, yep, that's basically his notes and everything, you know, thinking what he can do to improve the ship. So, yeah, Thomas Andrews is basically from Ireland, and basically he has to work by traveling on board the RMS Titanic, and he tends to be homesick, as we all understand that. So, our good friend Charles Yalkin actually did a good favor for him, was baking Mr. Andrews some Irish soda bread and delivered it to his cabin. And this story is actually never heard on board the RMS Titanic whatsoever. So that's a very, very lighthearted event that actually did happen on board the ship as well. So also, Mr. Ismay actually did have some friends over in his stateroom. And there was also a dinner party that actually did happen in the first class lounge. Not lounge of restaurant whatsoever, or the dining room. So basically everything seems ordinary whatsoever.
On this day, 112 years ago, on April 13, 1912, it's considered one of the most eventful days on board the RMS Titanic.
The first note is that Titanic is actually making a lot of progress whatsoever, and the crew and the passengers actually did notice that the Titanic might get to New York earlier than expected. Now, voyages are actually marked with light ships whatsoever. You got one in Southampton, and you got one in New York City whatsoever. You pass one in Southampton, your voyage starts. Pass it in New York, guess what? It's over. Or vice versa, like if you pass the first light ship in New York, voyage begins, pass it in Southampton, it ends.
Another notable thing that we have to remember that deep inside the Titanic's boiler rooms, there has been a coal fire that has been burning in boiler room number 6. Now, coal fires are very common in steamships, and the way to handle it is to shovel out the coal and move it alongside. The unburned coal is moved to the port side coal bunker, and this actually influenced the trim of the Titanic. So much coal that was actually moved that she actually has a 3 degrees list to port.
So a few passengers actually did notice the effect on the ship's list whatsoever. There was a passenger by the name of Irene Harris, and as she was actually walking down the grand staircase whatsoever, she was actually on her way to the reading and writing room, which I actually did found, you know, ship's plans, and basically there was a map that actually told me, okay, she was heading to the reading and writing room. The grand staircase floor actually has a linoleum tile, and it's very shiny, very expensive at the time frame, and all of it could be located in the first class area for the grand staircase. And as she was actually walking down the stairs, she actually did not notice that the ship's list actually had a little effect whatsoever. So basically it's about 2-3 degrees to port, slightly noticeable by others. So as she was actually walking down, she actually lost her footing and then actually tumbled and broke her arm. So she was taken to the ship's doctor and she actually got patched up and went back to dinner in the first class dining room whatsoever. And also, as the Titanic was sailing on, passengers like to send, you know, loved ones and friends back home on via telegram, so you know how the ship is doing, how the ship's performing. So there's two men named Jack Phillips and Harold Bride. They were actually working on sending out private messages for the passengers. And so the way they would work is they would actually send out the telegrams, but also inform the crew and the captain of any ice within the route that they are taking.
Phillips was on his ship when he was having issues with the wireless machine. After 11 p.m., the apparatus broke down, and Phillips tried to troubleshoot the issue, you know, trying to find out what the cause was. He finally woke up Bride, who was asleep in the wireless cabin, and decided to find a solution to fix the machine. However, doing so actually has two things. One, it's a violation of company policy, and two, had they not repaired the machine, the sinking of the Titanic would actually have huge repercussions whatsoever.
So unfortunately, in the Marconi Wireless Company's policy, should an apparatus actually do break down, the operator should not attempt to fix it whatsoever until the vessel reaches dry land and a certified technician boards the ship to serve the apparatus. So the problem is with this apparatus is that the leads for the secondary of the transformer actually burnt through the casing and actually damaged some of the iron bolts. So Phillips attempted to fix it with rubber tape and it actually worked whatsoever. So at 5:30 a.m. ship's time on April 14th, 1912, the machine is actually back up and running again. But unfortunately, there's actually a huge backlog of messages that had to be sent. Now, think about this for a second. If that apparatus were to remain down throughout the whole duration of the sinking, more lives would have been lost. It is on this day, April 14th, 1912, 112 years ago today. This is a day that many of us actually know is one of the most infamous encounters, but we're actually going to get to that a little bit later on. So what we're going to do, we're going to look through the events that actually led up through the night. Now, keep this in mind, though, whatsoever, there is new information in this part that actually did surface, so we're actually going to look into it. So that's the reason why I actually do want to cover this part first, and then we get into the encounter with the iceberg. Now, the first of all that you need to remember is that the Titanic's engines are now recorded up to 75 RPMs and actually reach a top speed of 22 knots, which is very, very good whatsoever. Now, another thing that we have to remember is separating fact from what we actually believe in. Now, as we all know, Titanic was originally supposed to have a lifeboat drill on that day, on Sunday, April 14, 1912, as it is very religiously for Captain Smith to do that. And what we used to believe is that the captain actually canceled it due to Sunday services, but that is actually not the case whatsoever. However, a testimony was actually came up. A couple of friends of mine actually shared it to me whatsoever. It's from one of the lookouts from the Titanic. His name is Archie Jewell. Actually did shed some light on why this lifeboat drill was actually canceled whatsoever. There is a video from this channel. Now, I collabed with a lot of different narrators, and it was actually a lot of fun, too. I actually got to portray myself as Senator Smith in this video, so do feel free to check it out. I will leave a card at the top corner of your screen.
The man you see in this photo is Archie Jewell. He is one of the six surviving lookouts to the sinking of the RMS Titanic and also a survivor of the sinking of the HMHS Britannic. He testified in the British Red Commissioner's inquiry about why the lifeboat drill was canceled. He stated that it was due to strong wind and rain that occurred on the dawn of April 14, 1912.
So the strong wind was actually blowing hard, thus the reason why the lifeboat drill was actually canceled in the first place. Now, can you imagine trying to lower a lifeboat with strong winds? It'd be very dangerous. I could see why it was canceled. So the reason of this cancellation was actually told to all crew members whatsoever. So there were actually some speculation, you know, that the captain told his close crew members and also the six lookouts as well. So basically everyone else just kind of, you know, received word of it. And then all of a sudden it's like, okay, back to work, there we go. Now, Sunday services were actually held throughout the ship whatsoever. So first class actually have service in the first class dining room, which is right around down here, to which they actually did sing hymns that ironically one would actually be Eternal Father, Strong to Save, which actually then did ended with the ironic lyrics of For Those in Peril on the Sea Whatsoever.
Did you know the infamous I'm Flying scene from the 1997 Titanic movie? Well, if you do, it's one of the most recognizable moments in cinema history. But did you know that this scene is a reference to a real-life passenger who visited the forecastle deck on the ship? Yes, that's actually very true. The lady you see in this photo is Helen Candy. She is an American author, journalist, decorator, feminist, and geographer. She's best known as a survivor, and her later work as a travel writer and explorer of Southeast Asia. She's traveling on the Titanic after she received a telegram from her daughter Edith advising that her son Harold has been injured in an accident. And for those that don't know what a forecastle deck is, it's the upper deck of a sailing ship towards the foremast, and this is where the front section of the ship. Titanic had heavy machinery such as the anchor crane, the giant anchor chains that we see on the wreck today, and a third anchor at the near prow of the ship. There are signs that are placed around warning passengers that the area is off limits and very dangerous.
So at 1:42 p.m., Captain Smith actually received a telegram from the SS Baltic saying that there's icebergs and large quantities of field ice. So unfortunately, that one's actually taken by Mr. Ismay, who actually did show it off to passengers whatsoever. So we're going to actually get to that rule soon later on. So, and then at 5 p.m., Titanic actually did report it at a location called The Corner. If you don't know what The Corner is, this is located at 42 degrees north and 47 degrees west. But when Captain Smith actually changed course, it actually led the Titanic to travel through a very, very known ice field. And by 5:50 p.m., that turn was actually from south 62 degrees to south 86 degrees west whatsoever, which is actually heading north-south about 71 degrees west. At 6 p.m., Second Officer Charles Lightoller actually began his watch on board the Titanic, where he actually did remain for 4 hours, even though when he had his dinner. So a handful of the officers were actually aware of the weather and the telegrams of the ice warnings. Now, he did a radio interview on BBC called I Was There in 1936, and I'm going to play an audio from that.
On that night of April the 14th, we all, that is, the captain and officers, knew perfectly well that we were just about entering the region where ice might be sighted at that particular time of the year, and had taken all necessary precautions.
So at 7 p.m., the temperature actually did drop from 43 degrees to 33 degrees, and this was actually very noticeable by the passengers. Now, think about this. April 14th is one of the very most unusual times out in the North Atlantic Ocean, because you have to remember, this is reported as clear and calm. Basically, the water's just basically flat. You know, you would think of, you know, a couple of rogue waves here and there, or some waves. That's not the case in this time. This is actually one of the most darkest days of all time in the year. So, first class passengers, you know, they begin to have their dinner. Bruce Ismay, who actually did still have the ice warning from the SS Baltic in his pocket throughout the day, he was actually reported in the first class smoking room, where Captain Smith actually asked for the telegram from the Baltic back so that way it could be posted in the chart room whatsoever. Ismay actually did comply, gave the captain back the telegram, and actually did all that before actually serving dinner in the a la carte restaurant, but they were both sitting at separate tables, so basically, this dinner right here, for Captain Smith, it was basically a celebration for him. Basically, presumably retiring, to which it's not the case whatsoever, and my lights turned off, if you didn't see.
Before 9 p.m., Captain Smith returned to the bridge following his meal, where he was met with Charles Lightoller and 6th Officer James Moody. When the captain returned to the bridge, there were many stars in the night sky, but the Titanic was sailing on a calm, moonless night. At 9:20, Smith left the bridge, only to give 2nd Officer Charles Lightoller these instructions: if in the slightest degree doubtful, let me know. Minutes later, Moody telephoned the crow's nest and asked to look out for small ice. Then at 10 p.m., Lightoller was relieved by 1st Officer William Murdoch, and at the same time, Archie Jewell and George Simons were relieved by Frederick Fleet and Reginald Lee.
So between the times of 9:20 p.m. to 10 p.m., Jack Phillips was actually working on a backlog of messages to send to Cape Race whatsoever. Now, Cape Race is about 400 miles from the Titanic, so you have to think about this. Jack Phillips can only hear the faint dots and dashes, so he had to turn up the volume so that way he could be able to hear those faint dots and dashes. So he responded to a message from a steamship called the SS Mezaba, who actually delivered an ice report where the crew actually did say they saw heavy pack ice, large bergs, and field ice. But unfortunately, this message was actually never delivered whatsoever. It was very critical. It actually did came at 9:52 p.m.
And what happened with Jack Phillips led him to snap after listening to the SS Californian because of this incident with the Marconi apparatus the night before. Keep in mind that Jack Phillips had little sleep. While Phillips was listening to a telegram message for a first-class passenger by the name of Dorothy Gibson from Cape Race at 10:55 p.m., Cyril Evans, the only operator on the Californian, sends a message to Phillips saying, "Say, old man, we are stopped and surrounded by ice." This message was so strong that it came in a loud ring in Phillips' ear. The reason is the Californian signal was so close to the Titanic, and you have to keep this in mind. The closer you are, the louder you'll hear messages. And also another factor is that Titanic and Californian are using a spark gap wireless sets. Phillips had the volume on his apparatus up so he can hear the faint dots and dashes of Morse code from Cape Race. So this caused Jack Phillips to snap back by messaging Evans, "I am busy, I am working Cape Race, you are jamming my signal."
Now the popular contrary of Jack Phillips, you know, telling the Californian to keep out and shut up, was actually very, very blown out of proportion whatsoever. You have to think about this. Jack Phillips stayed up nearly 24 hours, you know, because the apparatus went down. He and Harold Bright had to fix it. So don't take what I say out of context whatsoever. You know, I get that frustration. You know, he got agitated. So basically, it was not very appropriate of him doing that whatsoever. He would have taken it in, you know, into consideration. The Phillips would actually do apologize to Cape Race and actually ask for Dorothy Gibson's message again whatsoever.
Afterwards, Evans on the Californian turned in for the night and shut down the Californian's apparatus, considering he is the only operator on board the vessel. And from here, this is where the turning point of maritime history would take place. As we come up at 11:39 p.m., Reginald Lee and Frederick Fleet spotted a large mass of ice directly in the path of the Titanic.